And now, it's that time of the week once again. Welcome to the Departure Lounge Podcast with your hosts, Tom Whittle and Steve Woldridge. Your ticket to the home of aviation podcasts. Sit back, relax, and enjoy the flight.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to episode number 51 of the Departure Lounge podcast here on the Departure Lounge YouTube channel, the weekly podcast where we bring you nothing but fun and games and talk nothing but aviation for the upcoming 90 minutes or so. My name is Tom Whittle, and joining me this evening for what should be a very fun show is, of course, I'm not really suited to this, but we'll go for it. It's Steve Woldridge. Steve, very good evening to you. How are you on this Wednesday evening?
All right, Tom, what's on? And everyone at home, I hope you're all well and looking forward to another good episode. Yeah, I'm all good. I'm on another 4-day week, so I can't moan too hard. And yeah, looking forward to arguing with each other tonight. It should be good fun.
It's going to cause a lot of interesting opinions, I think, especially in the chat as well. So we'll get on to what we're doing shortly, but I'll bring you back in a second. Click the button there. Also joining me this evening, and he's back after his week's break from, well, I say week's break, he wasn't here on Sunday. It is, of course, Ian Hartley. Ian, welcome back to the show. How are you?
Very well. Thanks, Tom. Sorry for missing Sunday's show. Something cropped up and I had to disappear. So, I'm sorry about that. And it was show 50 as well. But I have listened back and it was an absolutely fantastic show. And I have to say, being a viewer rather than the contributor, What a massive difference just to listen back to that one show. But it was a cracking show. So big shout out to Wally as well for being part of that show, and what a fantastic guy he is. Yeah, we're really absolutely. Really good.
Enjoying your week so far?
Happy days. Yeah. So I went fishing yesterday. I got 3 pike, and I've been after a decent double all season, and I finally landed. It was somewhere between 13 and 14 pound pike yesterday. So I'm really, really happy with that. In fact, I was that happy with it and going back tomorrow for another go. So
lovely.
So far, so good. Yeah.
Lovely. Very nice indeed. Yeah. We'll bring Steve back into the equation. I'll ask you the same question, Steve. Enjoying your week so far?
Yep. Monday I went and bought some clothes because I'm a trendy kind of guy and I need to keep looking up to date and that. And, obviously, Sunday, you know, I went to Heathrow and I've started sharing my photos. So, shameless plug here. Follow me on Steve_Planes on Instagram and you will see my adventures of Heathrow. So, yeah, definitely worth a follow. If you wouldn't mind, that would be most appreciated. And evening in.
Good evening, up, Steve.
Butter pie, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, absolutely. Butter pie up here. Yeah, butter pie gravy.
You're
absolutely.
Good?
Absolutely. Mushy peas, pee wet. Yeah, all good up here, Steve. How's Pastyland?
Still
as near as damn it.
Well, Tom's slightly nearer pasty than me, but it's still good, and we're still out harvesting the fields, ready to give you crops for the rest of the year because we're good like that down south.
Well, yeah, I'll tell you what, Steve. Looks like you've lost a bit of weight there, pal. You've been on a diet.
No, hang on. I just need to move my computer nearer. Here we go.
It's begun already. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Right, before we get into this evening's festivities, we'll go through some housekeeping before we get going. We are on social media, as we always say. You can find them in the descriptions below. You can find us on Instagram. We're probably going to get rid of Discord, But you can find us on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and Twitch if you fancy following us on there to keep up to date with everything that's going on, including the competition, which we're launching this evening as well, which we'll sort of talk about more towards the end of the show. Also, our shop, which is to do with the competition. So if you missed it last week, and for both shows, we spoke about the competition, which we'll go into more detail at the end, like we said. We have a shop. You can buy merch in a description below as well. Selling like hotcakes at the moment. So, do get in while you can and get the merch while it's there. Also, if you wish to be a guest on the show, feel free to message us on any of the social medias, such as our previous guests have done, to join us on the show for 90 minutes of good fun and laughter and lots of aviation chat. Right. Quick couple of comments, which we'll jump into. Ian, no need to read these out. It's not as strenuous as you think. Planespot 555 says, hi, guys. So hello to you. And Martin Waldridge asking, he says, hi, good evening. Where's Buckle?
Oh, yeah. Well, first up, right, Martin, never mind where Buckle is. If you can send some money down for Mum's birthday present shortly, that would be most appreciated. Thank you, mate.
There you go. Different kind of shout out on the show here. Yeah. Anyone watching, do feel free to comment or leave us a message and we'll show it on the screen throughout the evening. So tonight's show is an interesting one. It's something that we've decided to kind of do a little bit different in regards to how to present it. Normally we're very positive about stuff. Tonight we're going the opposite direction and we're going negative. I mean, you guys have obviously seen the TV show Room 101.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we know what it's about. But for anybody that doesn't know, Ian, I'll let you do the explanation on this because I'll probably end up mucking it up. So if you want to explain to the people watching just what Room 101 is.
Well, on the actual show, you had three guests and a host. Now, I can't remember who the last host was. I think it were Frank Skinner. It could have been someone like that.
It was Frank Skinner.
So what the show was about was you'd sit there and you'd have a gripe about something, a pet hate if you want, whether it's, well, a pet hate about just absolutely anything. So what you'd have to do is sell your argument to Frank Skinner, and he'd sit there and he'd decide whether it went into Room 101 or didn't go into Room 101. Now, Room 101 is a room what things go into and just never come back out again. So if it did get into Room 101, that was the end of it. But on a lot of occasions, the argument wasn't strong enough for it, so we didn't actually make it. So it's pretty much similar to that, but it's our pet hates, I suppose, about aviation, anything to do with any aviation. And we'll sort of toss it off amongst ourselves. Well, argue it amongst ourselves, if you know what I mean. Yeah. Argue amongst ourselves.
Jeez, honestly.
It was pancake day yesterday, Ian. You're too late, mate.
Sorry about that. Yeah. So we'll argue about it amongst ourselves. And
great save.
Get the crowd involved as well. And let them have their opinions on it too, and we'll see if we get sort of a majority decision on whatever the pet hates. So that's it.
Absolutely. So we're gonna bring up some subjects that we find to be quite irritating or just a massive pet peeve for us, and then we're gonna throw it to the comments and see what the comments say, whether they agree with it, disagree with it, and then we'll make our decision from there. Hopefully that sort of makes a bit of sense as to what we're doing this evening. Let's get started and see what kind of controversy we can kind of conjure up this evening. Rob Brown has popped in to say, evening troops, hope all is well.
Yep, all good. Rob,
how you doing?
Yeah,
all good here as well. Okay, so we've got 15 topics to go through. It should take us up right until we end the show. So first one that we're going to bring into the equation is, and we know whose this is, first one is wing walkers, and who would like to claim that one?
That's one of mine, that. I just don't understand them. I just don't get it at all, wing walking. I can't see the point in being stood on the strapped to the wing of a plane. Now, we've all seen wing walkers when we've been to these air shows, and to be fair, it's on a biplane. It's always on a biplane, obviously, and they're stood on top of this wing, and because of health and safety, this, that, and the other, they're probably 300 or 400 feet up in the air and probably about a quarter of a mile away from where you stood. So, number one, you can't see them. It's just a dot on a wing. And then the guy, the commentary guy, will say, right, and wave to the lovely wing walker who's on top, and because they'll be waving at you as they fly past. So they fly past at something like 120 knots. So they pass you in the blink of an eye as well. And then the wing will be obscuring their view, and your view will be obscured by the wing to their view as well. And I just don't understand why they have to have them. They could just do away with it. Just get the biplane to do a bit of something or other, a bit of acrobatics or whatever, and just leave the wing walker on the beach with a pint watching. I just don't understand. I'm sure they'd prefer it. I just don't see how the crowd engages with it, and I just don't see how the crowd, I don't know, even, I don't get it. So, Yeah,
well, up until the Bournemouth Air Show, I would have agreed they weren't any kind of spectacle. But obviously, what would have happened at Bournemouth this year, would admire the bravery, and if it wasn't for them, we couldn't have laughed at Isaac Cowley's incredibly poor-timed video of Live and Let Die every time he showed the wing walkers from the air show.
But this is true.
To sort of counterbalance it, it's not the most favourite thing at the air show, but like I say, off the back of the air show, I do have a bit of respect and newfound sort of like kudos for the bravery. The fact they managed to save lives rather than ditch into a busy beach, but yeah, before that, I agree, they're fairly boring.
Mm-hmm.
I'll pipe in and say that I've kind of got to agree with Ian. Like, as much as it's kind of, you know, as much as the whole thing is, it takes a lot of bravery to do it, and you know, fair play to them and stuff. But you know, there are a lot of there's better things to do than, you know, sit on top of a plane and stuff and swing around like you're a second propeller or something. Do you know what I mean?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, doing it as an extreme sport sort of thing, as an experience, would be fantastic. You know, actually going down to, I don't know, your local airport, getting on a biplane and doing a few circuits of the airport as a wing walker. I think for the person being up there, if it was just Joe Public and they were doing it for Joe Public, I think that'd be fantastic. But as it, like you say, Steve and Tom, as a spectacle at an air show, it's not really up there, is it? It's more of a gap filler than anything else, I think, isn't it?
Like I said, if I was on top of the wing walking plane, I'd look like a dog with its head out the window, with my cheeks flapping around and spit all over my face and all that. It'd be a right old mess. Maybe it'd be more of a spectacle to see me on there in a little leotard and that.
It'd just be amazing to see you on the plane.
Yeah. That's it, thinking I can do anything for love as you're flying past everyone.
Like a Meatloaf tribute.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Throw your hair out, you'll be fine.
Yeah, no, it was a shame what happened at Bournemouth, but I am siding with you that they're. I didn't go to the air show and go, oh, what brilliant, they got wing walkers. It's just part of the day. And as it happens, they walked away from it and they ended up being an inconvenience because we missed some really good stuff that afternoon. So, yeah.
Yeah, they were very, very lucky, weren't they? And fair play to them. God, it's not many people who get out of that in one piece, especially a wing walker on top.
Well, so but she managed to climb back in, but look, yeah.
All right.
Fair play.
Fair play. Absolutely.
One for you, Ian, from Martin Woodridge. So there's footage of a wing walker crashing into Poole Harbour, if that cheers you up.
Well, you know.
Planespotter 555 says, for goodness sake, because you mentioned his poorly timed video.
It was fantastic. If you get the, if you don't follow Isaac on Instagram, it's one of the funniest videos you could possibly see. As everyone walked away from it, there was no lasting damage. It's well worth a look for how poorly timed the music is on it.
I might see if I can find it actually while we're on this topic.
Yeah, yeah, that'd be cool.
Martin Waldridge then says, maybe pilot Johnny can strap you to the top of his
A340. I'd
settle just for going inside the A340 with him for a little trip round to begin with. Let's not get too far ahead of ourselves.
Talking of being inside an aircraft, Jack Rolls is it? He's not. He's not. He's not. He's not. Planespotter 555 says, you dare. So, yeah.
You dare, Tom. Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, well,
you
dare. The gauntlet's been thrown down.
Absolutely. Yeah,
talk amongst yourselves whilst I find it.
When did you last see Wing Walkers here and yourself?
Probably Blackpool Airshow, going back, it's a few years ago now, isn't it, since we last had decent Airshow. So, we've not had the Airshow for the last 2 years, so... It'll be the year before that. So 2019 it would have been, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it'd be more impressive if they were in pairs and they were like jumping off and landing on the other one. That'd be a bit more exciting.
Well, that's it. I mean, they could have trapeze dangling underneath them and all sorts, couldn't they?
Yeah. Maybe we could put a little request out to make it more entertaining.
Yeah. I think we used to get the, were they Crunchy or something? The two biplanes, what they used to
crunchy,
have.
Crunchy, yeah. God, I remember that.
Oh, yeah.
The Crunchy. And I think Breitling sponsored them for a while as well, didn't they?
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, that's Rob Brown saying Blackpool 2019.
Mm. Yeah, I think, I forget what they were now. The pair we had, there was a white one and an orange one, and it was the white one that unfortunately... binned it. I don't make light of it. It was an incredibly
It could have been really bad, couldn't it?
Mm. Pilot error. Yeah, there was no inconvenience that it got cancelled. I say that tongue in cheek because ultimately everyone walked away from it relatively unscathed. So that was the main thing from it.
Yeah. Rob Brown saying he thinks we're a Dury Milt one as well. So. I remember that back in 2019, I went to Blackpool. I went as the planes were coming into Blackpool Airport, and I remember it was an absolute blistering day. And I went in sort of late evening when Red Arrows were coming in and stuff like that. And we had the Battle of Britain Memorial flight that came into Blackpool that night, and they all landed because the hurricane were coming down. It did a missed approach. He had his roof open and everything, and he just sort of came down, sort of just went to land, missed it, and then shot off again while the old Spitfire and Lancaster that came in and landed, and all Red Arrows came in. God, there were all sorts coming in that night. It was fantastic. Really good. And the Saab Gripens and things like that. Yeah, fantastic.
Yeah.
I want to throw it to the comments just while we sort of finish up on the topic here, because we've got quite a few to go. I want to know what people think of the Wing Walkers. Are they for you, or are they sort of something that you would rather miss at an air show? Put it into the chat, and we'll make our decision as to whether it gets a yes from us or a no in terms of going into our little secret room that we have. I'm having trouble finding this video.
Isaac's probably deleted it really quickly. That's the problem.
Quicker than anyone changes their underpants, I think. But can't find it at the moment. So if you have to, that's a shame. But like I said, let us know what you think of Wing Walkers. Are they for you? Are they not for you? Just very quickly, whilst we sort of await some comments to come in, your Heathrow trip, anything exciting that you saw?
The new ITA livery is unbelievable, out of this world, beautiful. I was quite happy to see the Singapore 777. That was a nice sort of one I've not seen for a good while. And the Red Devil Brussels Airlines was incredibly stunning, and we had a great day, like the weather and that, and yourself. You went Friday. What about you, Tom?
Yeah, I went on the Friday. Do you know what? It turned out to be sort of one of the better days for it. They were all westerlies, so 27 left arrival. And yeah, Air China 777 that was delayed, which I know you love, Steve.
Dirty.
It was very dirty. The Belgian Icons Brussels A320 was nice to get. Finally managed to get one of those, so that was nice. The British Airways BEA Retro was now ticked off my list. BA Better World, or TTNA as I call it.
Yeah,
we had that twice. on Sunday, yeah, as well.
Beautiful. I do like that one. It is really nice, that one.
Yeah, got it twice. So waiting for it once, came in first thing in the morning, and then saw that it was coming back from Geneva in the afternoon before the switch. So I was like, nice, okay, lovely. Got that. Turkish 350, which was nice. I'm trying to think what else there was. A couple of Swiss A220s. Did see taxing for departure. I sent it in our little chat that we've got. The China Eastern 777 that was painted up in the sort of the sky blue color.
Ooh,
nice. I did send a picture of it into the chat, but
yeah. Which one have you got, the TAP Retro?
Yeah, that was myself. Yeah.
Well, that's a fantastic looking plane. That it really is.
Yeah, the old red seat line down it.
Just very quickly, Isaac. Yes, please send it into the send it to Messenger.
But yeah, we're on Eastley, so 09 left, which is it's a lot easier because you don't have to actually drive into Heathrow. You can park it the other side of the 25 and walk in and just sit in this field, and there's no one around. It's fantastic. So good to go there.
Yeah, I prefer the takeoffs, if I'm honest, if they're on Eastleys, because they also make some nice banking shots as well.
If people in the chat or whoever haven't been to Heathrow, then drop Tom or I a message, because we can certainly sort of help you out on where to go and sort of where to avoid and what have you. So we'd be more than happy to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So got a couple. Rob Brown Planespotting says that Wingwalkers are not for him.
Yeah.
So another one in there as well. So I think we'll probably leave that and go, Wingwalkers are a big no-no. So
I think that in Steve's, stick it in Steve's fridge with his Camembert.
Steve's fridge, yeah, Camembert.
Interestingly, there's a fact at home you might not have known. If you leave Camembert in your fridge, it doesn't actually go mouldy. It just goes rock hard. I threw it out for the birds and even turned their nose up at it. So, yeah, who knew?
You expected to do nothing else but go rock hard.
Had a broken bacon. It's not your fault.
Fantastic. Wonderful. Right, let's get on to... I tell you what, we've got a new face Reece, in the chat. Yeah, it's only Reece Davies. Hi, Reece.
How are you, Reece?
He is watching.
Hello, mate. How you been? Extenders
on planes. I wish there was a way to have them subtly rather than asking the cabin crew. Always felt judged by the staff. I don't want to be treated differently or felt like that. That's fair enough.
No. Yeah, no, that's I don't think any of us have got any complaints.
That's a good shout, enough. That. Exactly. Yeah. Anyone else got any sort of ideas for what they would put into a room 101? Chuck it into the comments and we'll get it sorted. Right. Just a nice little treat before we do go on to the next one. I do have said video that has been sent. I'm just going to sort this out now. He's had to screen record it. So hopefully the sound is going to be there. Right, here we go. Let me go back. Hang on, I don't have the sound on. Live and let die. Live and let die. Live and let die. It's poorly timed.
Oh dear.
Thank you for sharing that. Yeah, thank you for that. That's poorly timed.
I've mopped in for the last 7 months or however long it's been for that. Absolutely brilliant.
Yeah. I played it the first time and completely forgot that I had the mute button on. But yeah, poorly timed. And he's happy because it means he gets a shout out. So well done to you.
Yeah, go and give him a follow for it.
Yeah, go give him a follow. Plane spot of 555. Might as well. Worth a follow. Right, so we're going to move on to the next one now, and I'm going to go for another one that I thought was quite funny. So
can I just interrupt you quickly? Sorry, Tom, you've totally froze on my screen. What about you, Steve?
No, Tom's good on mine, and so are you. Okay. I'm good at my end.
Okay, right. Ian's
the only one that's frozen on mine.
Yeah, okay, must be my internet. I don't know what's up with that. Sorry, what?
Next one. An interesting one. It's no more boiled sweets. Who wants that?
Me.
Steve, take it away.
Well, back in the glory days when you went flying, the cabin crew would come round with a little selection of boiled sweets to help with your ear pressure came into land. And they've disappeared these days. And when you think of the price of airline tickets and the like, a little boiled sweet wouldn't go amiss. And I'll tell you now, my grandmother, she never claimed to be an international company of any description, but every week my brother and I went round and we'd always get a Werther's original. So it's about time these airlines brought back the boiled sweet, because it's an absolute outrage.
I mean, of all the things to kind of moan about when it comes to aviation, like boiled sweets is one that I didn't even think about. So, you know, well done for thinking outside the box.
Yeah. Like, I don't expect it on a Ryanair or whatever, but a little boiled sweet wouldn't go amiss. I've had to sneak polos through security, and they're all getting contaminated in X-ray juice as they go through the scanner there. And, like, just give us a lollipop or something. It's not difficult. I'm dismayed and disgruntled with the airline industry for denying us a little sugary treat on the descent into whatever airport we're going into.
Yeah. Ian, I'm interested to kind of get your view on this. No more boiled sweets. Like, what? I mean, yeah, come up with something. Go on.
I have no idea what to say to that, to be quite honest with you. I mean, from an industry point of view, Steve, they are a choking hazard for smaller children, and the overall cost of the boiled sweet on an aircraft would be phenomenal. Now, speaking from an airliner's point of view, again, we've looked at it through and we've contacted our lawyers, and the lawsuits through chipped dentistry, choking hazard, and kids with sugar rushes would be detrimental to the aviation industry. So therefore, we've had to take them away.
Well, I would counter your argument and say, if you've ever been on a Ryanair landing, you tend to smash out your teeth on the headrest in front as it parks into the tarmac. So that argument doesn't stand.
Yeah.
And also, you sit on a seat and there's a boiled sweet on there, and it gets stuck on your trousers, and you're going back to your hotel on your transfer, and all of a sudden you feel there's a boiled sweet on your trousers. You've got a boneless little sweet for later on. You don't think of these things. Like, it's the gift that keeps giving.
It's grim is what it is.
Yeah, it is. Isn't it? I think they were taken away for a reason, Steve. And I think it was more to do with just the probably costs and the fact that it only takes what I mean. My daughter's choked on Werther's originals before today, and you know, and I've had to give her a smack on the back to get it back up again. So if she can do it, anyone can do it. So I wouldn't risk it. I wouldn't risk the lawsuit.
Yeah. Rob Brown, Rob Brown, Plane Spotting says it's an airline, not Kojak. Who loves you, baby?
Another point as well.
Go on.
I think the pressure in the airlines is not as harsh, I suppose, as what it were. So do you actually need them? Is the ear popping thing, because that's all to do with air pressure and things, isn't it?
Possibly.
Yeah, but a cheeky little cheeky little humbug. You're flying back home. You haven't seen your family for months and months. You're walking through arrivals. You've got minty fresh breath. No one wants to be hugging a relative with dog breath. They're not thinking about the relatives in all this. So absolutely no thought. And they could even give you a Tic Tac. If we're worried about choking, pass around some Tic Tacs. Nobody's asking for a donkey choker. Just a little Tic Tac would do the job.
Nah, I can just imagine Messi did leave.
Honestly, people wonder why I'm tired all the time, because this kind of stuff keeps me up at night.
Martin Waldridge says a Fox's Glacier Mint.
Oh, like, yeah, that's what Grandma used to dish out. They were amazing.
If you had to pick a bold sweet on the plane, what would it be?
Well, being quite a fat bloke, on the A380, I'd go over the bar and change it to a pick-a-mix, to be fair. But if we're being reasonable about this, yeah, I'd take like a humbug, something like that, a little bit of minty freshness. And you've got a nice little toffee centre. All those blackcurrant licorices. Oh, you know you're on a good airline if they show up.
Yeah, I don't like licorice, so I wouldn't go for that. I'd go for, like, you know, the travel sweets that come in, like, the little gold tins?
Oh, yeah.
The powder on that would send you doolally if you put one in your mouth.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I would do. That's what I would have.
I've not seen them since the 70s.
No, you know, the balls.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, covered in sugar.
That's right. I'd go for
they're like fruit flavours and stuff like that.
That's right,
back the car, there's powder everywhere.
That's right, yeah. God, I've not seen them for years. I would have just gone for a glass of mint, but the fruit-flavoured ones.
Oh, they're amazing.
Yeah, the fruit-flavoured ones. And if it was Steve got on my plane, it'd be a gobstopper for him.
And to be fair, chaps, if this doesn't make it in, I pledge if you see me on a flight in the future, anyone watching, I will have a pack or two, and I'll pass them around the whole plane, because I'm that passionate that everyone should have a sweet to suck on a descent. So that is my pledge today. You will not go short of a sweet.
Very good. Very good. Rob Brown, Plane Spotting, says, what's one sweet? Not much to ask. Not asking for a wallet. Busting pick and mix from Woolworths.
Rob knows his stuff. Although you never paid from it, Woolworths. It's probably why they went bust. You used to help yourself, didn't you, to more than what you paid.
You had them next to the front door, so you could go in, grab an handful and walk around shop while you're eating them, couldn't you?
Yeah, that's exactly that.
There'll be people watching going, what's Woolworths?
Yeah.
Millennials.
Yeah. Well, Martin Waldridge. Steve, what about an entire Viennetta to help with ears popping? I think he's trying to say something there. What's all that about?
Well, all I'd say to him is don't be stupid. It would melt. You'd just be left with a heap of chocolatey bits and loads of cream on your lap. He hasn't thought it through, has he?
No, he hasn't thought that through at all.
Someone's done their research, honestly.
You'd have to eat it beforehand, wouldn't you? And hope it carried on over for you.
Excellent. Right, over to the chat for this one. Would you welcome boiled sweets back onto a plane, or do you think that the time for the boiled sweets on a plane has come to an end? Let us know whilst we have a bit more of a chat. Ian, so we had Alison Port on the show a couple of weeks back. She's flying out in 24 days. You plan to be there?
Providing it's a weekend day. It's a Saturday, isn't it, when she's flying
out? I believe
out.
It is.
Yeah. Weather pending. If the weather's decent, I'll definitely go down and have a look. I want to make a banner, you know, a massive banner with your name on or something. So when she's taxiing, when she's tonking down runway, just about to V1, she'll see this banner.
Bring back sweets. To be fair, she's been doing her Instagram lives recently, because she's doing all her training and that, and it's really interesting. She's obviously obviously enjoying herself, and there's obviously a bit to learn and getting back up to speed where she's been, well, like everyone, been grounded for so long. So
absolutely,
yeah, fantastic. I'm so pleased for her to be back in the industry and at a top airline as well. Like, absolutely fantastic. Absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Definitely.
Yeah, well worth following and watching her lives and stuff if you want to. And of course, we get a cheeky shout out as well to the hundreds and hundreds of people that watch. So it's quite nice, actually. So it's like a nice little association. But we'll move on from that. I'm going to say that, I mean, just purely for the fun side of the chat, we'll put that in the room as well. So we'll go for that. Right. Okay. So on to the next one. And it's going to be airlines screwing up a new livery. And I'll take ownership of this one if you don't mind. So airlines nowadays, of course, are switching liveries to, you know, freshen things up for the airline. But what really grabs my goat and really gets on my last nerve is how generic and how boring they can be. We've got such examples as Iberia, for example. That's one where you take a classic livery and just make it as generic as possible. I mean, red and yellow, you know, colors of Spain. Ooh, nice one. You know, Qantas, it, you know, stick it down the back end of the tail and stuff. Red and yellow to represent Spain, job done. Boring. Don't need it. Icelandair have done the exact same, except they'll try and make some different colors up for the outline because they'll think they're trying to be clever. With great big billboard titles of Icelandair, doesn't work. Boring, ugly, disgusting. Nothing's fun anymore. So my gripe with this is that for a plane spotter, at least, I know it's for a business sense and it's to save money because it's, you know, there's not so much money to be spent in terms of dishing out paint, unless you're Emirates, of course. Nothing is exciting anymore in terms of trying to capture, you know, you remember, like, you know, going to like Heathrow or Manchester and you're like, oh, there's an Icelandair coming in, that's quite nice. Where now you go, that's Icelandair, look at the livery, it's not great at all, but you know, you got to catch it for the fact you've seen it, sort of thing. And I just think the airlines could be a bit more creative. There's been some examples that have been pretty good in terms of making it simple, like Aer Lingus. They've gone down the same way, but it just looks a whole lot nicer with the green and the green engines and stuff like that. So not everybody can get it right, but it's just, if you're going to design a new livery and you got these people that are paid hundreds, like thousands of pounds, dollars, whatever, to design a livery, and as Rob Brown Plane Spotting so politely puts it, its livery is now sponsored by Crayola and designed by 3-year-olds.
Yes, there's some exceptions to the rule. I think the new Lufthansa looks better than the old one, but generally speaking, yeah, you're not far wrong. There's some absolute classics that have been sort of put by the wayside because of all this. Like
some look seeing them on,
yeah, like Aer Lingus. I'm sort of torn whether I prefer the full green one or the newer one. Yeah, like you say, and borderline criminal, isn't it? I think I've said more than once what American did getting rid of their chrome was absolutely criminal.
Criminal, yeah.
I think I tend to agree with you. I think, like you say, you've got Aer Lingus and I'm just trying to think of some more. I mean, I'll be honest with you about the Icelandair one. That doesn't really offend me that much, to be quite honest. But I think Lufthansa looks nice as well. And I think things are Air France as well. But I think when you're used to seeing a white aircraft with a livery on it and then all of a sudden it's changed, I don't think whatever they do, you'd like it. I don't like it. I mean, when you look at British Airways' heritage, you know, since day one, you look at all their liveries and you look at the abomination they've got on now, then, well, yeah, it is, isn't it? In comparison to the ones what they've had in the past. And they, like you say, they've just gone for another lazy livery, haven't they, like everybody else has done? Even though it was one of the world tales, it still is. It's nothing compared to what they used to have, is it?
No. I've been a long-term fan of the fact that the current BA livery should probably be changed. I think it needs a change. I think it's, yes, it represents everything that's British and everything else. Yeah. I get that. But it needs a big sort of, you know, considering this was, you know, we discussed it many moons ago on our BA World Tales thingy. The livery they've got now was purely based for Concorde. And they've basically taken that and put it into the main fleet sort of thing. So I think for me, at least, it needs a freshen up, like a big freshen up. And, you know, whether we'll see that anytime soon, I wouldn't think so. And if we did, don't be surprised, considering it's IAG. IAG,
yeah.
Who will basically just go down the route of Iberia and just have it as blue and red.
Yeah. And I totally agree with you. I think they will. I think they'd just make matters even worse, wouldn't they? So I think we better just keep him quiet on that one and just enjoying it while we've still got it, I think, yeah?
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. But airlines screwing up liveries. So we've obviously mentioned ourselves about airlines that have particularly ruined liveries. Obviously, Steve, you're quite passionate about the American one. I'm sort of quite passionate about quite a few liveries that have been mucked up, such as the Iberia one. The Aer Lingus one, I preferred the old one to begin with, but this new one's now warming up big time. Like once you see it in the flesh, it's actually quite nice. Mm-hmm. So I quite like it. So it's done right. Ian, if you could think of one off the top of your head that's not British Airways that an airline has decided to screw up, the ones that we haven't mentioned already, which one would it be?
Well, I'll tell you what, I'm just going to go straight back to TAP again. Because for a simple reason, no, because one of my gripes is lazy liveries, and I've always said that TAP is a lazy livery. Whether it's right, whether it's wrong, whether I'm right, whether I'm wrong, I don't know. But I'll always say that TAP's got a lazy livery. Now, when you got a picture of that retro TAP coming into Heathrow, Steve, on Sunday, compared to what they've got now, you'd have to agree, wouldn't you? Because the retro livery is absolutely gorgeous compared to that livery they've got now.
Well, the only thing on TAP is it's more identifiable as its nation now, isn't it? That's the only thing you'd say compared to the old livery. But I do prefer the old livery, but I'm just saying the new one's more identifiable of its country of origin.
Yeah.
There's an argument in there with the old livery of TAP where you say that this one's more identifiable with Portugal because you've got the cheat line is the red and green of the flag.
It's more standoutish now, isn't it? Of course,
it's more standoutish now. Yeah, but I do like the old TAP livery with the cheat line and stuff. But I quite like the one at the moment that they've got.
Yeah, I don't argue that the retro is very very nice aircraft.
Yeah, I don't think the current livery needs changing. If anything, so every time I see one now, the first thing I think of is Ian.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I'll never get my head around it. I mean. Can you think of any airliners who have actually improved and you've thought to yourself, well, thank God they've got rid of that old livery and they've got this one now instead. Are there any? I think you could Emirates, perhaps. Not Emirates. Etihad, perhaps. I don't know.
Yeah, Etihad could be on the list.
Mm. I won't mention the company, but there is one recently that's changed and I prefer it, but for political reasons I'm not going to mention their name.
Just trying to
sort of think off the top of my head because there's so much that you can so much that you can go through. I can't think off the top of my head.
Yeah, Virgin's is nice, isn't it? But it's still got a lot of red involved, doesn't it?
Now that they've got, I like it.
It's a classy red on the Virgin, really classy red.
Yeah. But you could name more aircraft, more carriers who have ruined delivery than what you can who have actually improved delivery.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, undoubtedly.
So from a spotter's point of view, it's gone backwards, hasn't it? From an aesthetic point of view.
But the thing to remember and the thing to be kind of very sort of the thing you've got to think about is that airlines don't think about spotters.
No, of course you don't. No.
It's all a business. It's business driven. Yeah, so they'll think absolutely. If they can cut corners by saving themselves money, they'll do it by making.
Absolutely. Yeah. Totally. Yeah.
For example, the worst lot of them, the worst culprit of them all is China Eastern.
Oh yeah, we saw one Sunday.
That beautiful like cheat line livery. It was really nice. It was really like classy sort of thing. And then they went. We'll just get rid of everything, just put a little bit of font on there, put the tower logo, done.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah.
what did Thomas Cook used to do? They used to just stick Thomas Cook on side of anything, didn't they?
Yeah, but they actually had colour.
Well, yeah, true. Yeah. I'm just thinking of the hybrids, what they used to have after the other aircraft failures and whatever. Yeah, Monarch and others, weren't they?
Could have been worse. They could have painted the plane white and just had Thomas Cook on.
Well, you know.
Right, so let's go from this one here. Rob Brown, playing spot, and echoing what I said, which was IAG are the worst offender, or one of the worst offenders, which is completely true. Martin Waldridge says, firms go on about brand identity, but then produce a homogenized load of dull, rubbishy, whatever. I had to read that word then and make sure it wasn't anything else. Then he points, Rob Brown, pointing out that Brussels Airlines and Croatian are nearly the same. No real identity to either.
Yeah, absolutely.
Very, very similar. It's not good at all. One, Tian Hartley has joined us.
Oh, hang on.
Okay, guys. So, Steve, would you like to be honest and show your curtains? It's curtain watch, everybody. PlaneSpot 555 pointing out that TUI, in terms of, I think, ones that have improved their liveries, TUI being one of them. I think so.
Yeah, TUI are nice-looking planes.
So I'm going to say that is going to go into the room as well, I think. We're off to a good start so far.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to start to remove them because otherwise I'll get confused. So, yeah, so there's that one. Do then right? Okay, we're going to get onto a bit more of the controversial side of things now. So, who would like to claim stalking flight radar and posting it on Facebook as a disaster? Who would like to claim that one?
I'll claim that one. Now, go for it. What my beef is with this? I mean, we've all got social medias like Facebook and what have you, and obviously. You're all parts of these different spotting groups and all the rest of it. And as soon as your iPhone or your iPad or whatever pings to say that a plane squawking 7700, within 5 minutes, you've got posts up on your social medias sort of wishing it out at Sky sort of thing. And I don't know whether it's just my interpretation of it, but when I look at some of these posts and I look at them and I think to myself, these people are like eerily watching this plane because they think it's going to fall out of the sky just because it squawked 7700 or something. And it really, really bothers me that these people actually exist, you know, and they're sat looking and waiting for, you know, they're sat looking and watching flight radar hoping that something bad happens. So they can probably post it on Facebook or something like that. You know what I mean? And it that really, really bothers me. It really, really does. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I know. When you get the alert, we all watch them out of interest to see where they're going to divert to, how quick their descent, etc. But yeah, there's certainly no morbid fascination. I'm not hoping it plants itself into the ground. I'm certainly not about to bang it on Instagram or anything, unless something ridiculously unusual is about to head to Bournemouth. That's the only time I might potentially share it. If something you wouldn't expect to see in Bournemouth was going to head to Bournemouth, but yeah, I certainly wouldn't watch it from a morbid fascination. That's for sure.
No, absolutely not.
No.
Well, like you say, I mean, we all have a look, don't we, to see what the aircraft is and see where it's, like you say, where it's going to get diverted to or whatever. But then if you start scrolling through social media, you'll see that such and such a plane squawk 7700, what's up with it? Is it like, and you start looking at some of the comments on it and you just know that. So they're not saying it directly, but you can see, that they're going around the houses with what they're trying to say, but you know the point they're trying to make. And it's that what really, really bothers me. Yeah. I just don't think it's nice at all. No,
I don't think so. I think I know there'd be some people that I think will want to do it for like attention purposes and to kind of have a little bit of, you know, like a heated debate sort of thing, but about something that's kind of very, very sensitive, especially if it's something so harmless as, you know, you don't even know what that plane is squawking for anyway.
No, absolutely not. No, it might be something absolutely minor. It might just, yeah, absolutely.
Rob Brown, plane spotting, for example, says bad weather diversions end up going the same way too on social media.
Yep, absolutely.
People think bad weather and the plane's going to crash or something, and they're all just glued to it, thinking no one's going to go down.
Well, I mean, we've seen that firsthand all the week, haven't we? Storm, whatever it was, and you know, a certain channel got so many people watching. Now, I'm not going to have a pop at the person who did the video. It's what he does for a living and all the rest of it. But to say that it got so many people viewing it, they weren't just viewing it because they've got a fascination with aircraft like the rest of us. I think they were hoping to see something bad happen, to be quite honest. And I think it is a social media thing, and it's not good at all.
No, absolutely.
It's such a negative. Yeah, it can be such a negative thing.
And the problem is, again, we're not hanging out anyone to dry. Don't wrong, but these channels, not just the popular one, it's everyone. If they get a tail strike or something, they get so excited by it. It's not. Oh no! Did you see that? That's shocking. It's almost celebrated. You can't deny that happens. And these people who are watching aircraft potentially in distress, well, they're not celebrating it, but they want to sort of have a bird's eye view of it potentially going wrong and be able to say, oh yeah, I saw that, I tracked that, I saw that happen.
Yeah. And I think Martin Waldry's, it's a nail on the head, isn't it? This is a wider issue with people wanting to put things on social media. A few years ago, if an old bloke fell over in the street, people would rush over to help. Now they rush over to film it. And it's true. It really, really is. And I was actually going to say, with the social media side of things as well, you see it when there's a bit of a ruckus on a rowdy Ryanair flight or something like that, rather than the people trying to help out and calm these people down. Instead, they're all stood there pointing the mobile phones, aren't they? So they can get it onto social media.
Absolutely. Mm. It's a phone-driven age at the moment where it's, you know, you want to help yourself rather than help anyone else.
Mm. Yeah, well, that's what it's about, isn't it? It's chasing the likes, isn't it? That's what they're doing, aren't they? They just want the notoriety sort of thing. Yeah, it's not right. Mm.
It's a shame it's kind of that way where people are sort of sitting there hoping for something really bad to happen, you know? Mm. Like, I think it's different if you go out and you film in these storms, you know, we'll name drop because why not, you know, because it happened. You can't sit there and deny it. If, you know, channels like Big Jet TV, Speedbird TV, and like, you know, who was the other one? Like from Brussels to the sky or something when they were doing it from Amsterdam. I think these people will hope for these sort of, you know, there'll people be watching it, but like you said, not for the fact that it's, oh, you know, get to see the pilots, you know, been having their skills tested and things like that. Maybe some people there going, maybe one will crash.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Or you can put it on Facebook and stuff like that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's that 15 minutes of fame what they're after, isn't it? Some of them.
Yeah. And while you got, like, say, like your Big Jet TV and things like that, as you've seen in the streams and stuff, and as you've seen on like clips, where any sort of touchdown is always given with a, you know, woohoo sort of thing, you know, well done for getting it down. You got, you know, one or two people that are probably sitting there going, damn.
Yeah. It's going to be a marathon, isn't it? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So, yeah. No, it's disgraceful that it doesn't exist.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah, they do, don't they?
So true.
Yeah.
I'm munching on popcorn, by the way. It's very unprofessional, but I'm very hungry.
Fair dues.
Anyway. Yeah. So salted or I would sweet. Say this one goes...
Salted or sweet, mind?
Toffee.
Huh? Ooh, get you.
Yeah.
Other popcorn's available, of course, but there you go.
New channel sponsor. Thank you, Bust.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks for the free bags. Anyway, also playing Spotify by Five says the amount of rumors about both airshow crashes at Bournemouth had so many disrespectful videos. Now, I don't know because I haven't seen these ones, but Steve, I'm sure you can probably shed some light onto these.
Certainly, the unfortunate incident with the Reds. Fortunately, I had no interest. I only ever saw one video that actually made it to the news. But that afternoon, there were so many rumours that he was okay, he wasn't okay. And obviously, the sad facts was that he wasn't. But I think just generally in life, people should should avoid anything other than facts, because it's disrespectful, it's unnerving for family and friends and that, and it's just got to be a little bit more respectful when it comes to these things in general.
Absolutely.
Totally agree.
So, shall we put this in the room or no?
I would definitely put it in the room and turn the key and throw it away.
With you on that.
So well done, Ian, on that one. Righty ho, here we go. So next one, and this one really, really bugs me because you see a lot of, like, I've not experienced it, but I have seen passengers who rest their feet up on flights. Now, we've seen videos of these before where you got people with bare feet putting them on rests where people are sat and having no respect for anybody's, like, personal space. I think these people should be pushed out the plane at 30,000 feet and made to fall to their, you know, to an unfortunate demise. Because there's no need for it. You know, you don't, the fact that, you know, you've paid these hundreds of quid to go onto a plane. You're traveling 7-8 hours to, you know, across the pond, or you're going to, like, short haul to Munich and stuff. You got some smelly, you know, grubby feet in your face because some stupid, you know, I'm trying really hard not to swear at this point, but, you know, got some stupid, uncaring so-and-so that just decides to pop his feet up because he fancies it.
Yeah.
Like, and then just ruins your entire flight. Thankfully, I've not experienced it. I don't think any of us have experienced it, have we?
I'd say, as a counter-argument, when we went to New York on the 340, there was no one actually on our row. So we flatbedded it, but took our shoes off, like, some degree of respect. But yeah, if there was someone on the row you didn't know, I certainly wouldn't be putting my feet up. But the fact we could flatbed it in economy, I was all over that.
Yeah. I hate this with a passion, because it's like, I'm not doing that to you. I'm respecting the fact that you're on this flight as well. So I don't want you putting your trotters in my face and expecting me to sit there and like it.
Oh no, there's people near you, not a chance. You just sit there with your, well, it depends who you're flying with, but low cost, you sit there with your knees around your head paying stupid money for beer and you've got to lump it, haven't you? But
yeah. That's what I was just thinking. I mean, how on earth did they do it? How did they manage to get the feet up in the first place? They must have been contortionists to be able to get the feet out and squeeze them around and all the rest of it. It's not exactly a lot of room, is there?
You see the videos on, like, Facebook and stuff, didn't you? Where, you know, you're on a flight and that, and you've got somebody filming, like, you know, behind them, and you just see someone's feet, like, here. It's like, you just want to take a knife and just cut them off.
Well, maybe a bit extreme, but
no, if you're gonna put them
in, start lancing their balls and doing Veruca cream and that, I'll certainly have enough of that hat.
Yeah, well, I don't remember Ryanair putting that in their extra bookings, but there you go. Someone's beating my face. But Planespot 555 on this one says, if you're gonna do it, pay for two seats, which is fair enough.
Yeah.
Rob Brown, Plane Sporting, says, nearly as bad as the passenger in front of you reclining the seat without the courtesy of at least saying to you first. Yes. Oh, my God, yes. That I've experienced, where someone's declined, like, reclined the seat. Oh, and this was on, like, my Nuki to Gatwick flight, going to Gatwick. Somebody in front of me, wasn't the full flight, but somebody decided to sit in front of me and then reclined their seat. And I was just like, excuse me, like, literally, excuse me.
You start pushing it like that.
Literally, I'm just like, oh, sorry. Yeah, I'm just making myself comfortable with my shoulder.
Animals.
Wipes, honestly, wet wipes. Martin Waldridge, there's always someone sprawled out or spilling into the gangway like a burst couch.
It's usually because I've had too much beer in the in the airport beforehand. It's not something I can help.
No, that gets my goat as well. People that go onto a plane drunk.
I've never done it.
No, you got training instead, didn't you?
Yeah. Lightweight.
Yeah.
lightweight. Not much to say on this one, so we're going to probably not put this in the room, I don't think. I don't think it's going to be worth putting in there.
No, it's just general courtesy, isn't it, rather than
general
an aviation thing.
All it
is. The same applies on a train or a bus or whatever you would.
Absolutely, yeah, so. It's just manners, isn't it? Yeah.
Let's bring in some controversy for the next one. All right, who would like to take ownership of buying economy tickets and getting someone to photo you in business class for likes?
I'll have that.
Go on, Steve.
Right, first up.
Let rip. Let rip. Here we go.
I saw I don't even know her name, some woman who thinks she's famous, and she half threw someone out of a seat and did it and posed all like stupid poses and that just to get some likes on Instagram and that. Yeah. And it's an embarrassment. And then recently, that 380 flight, I saw someone else do it, and they pass it off like they've been there the whole time. And that chap in particular, I know his mum still buys his pants and socks for him, so there's no way he was flying business class on that flight and whatever. And look, it's just people who've got first names like Alvin, that kind of thing. It's just if you're on a nice plane or whatever, don't sit there and embarrass yourself by getting a flight attendant to take your photo in business class and then pass it off like you've been there the whole time. It is different if you go and visit the 747s on the ground and you get your seat photo taken in 1A, fair enough. You're on the ground, it's iconic, but when you're in the air, I guarantee you know, every single passenger in business and the cabin crew look at you and they think and they might say, what an absolute tool. And there's no question about it.
Yeah. Thank God you said tall, because Rob Brown playing sport and saying what everyone's thinking.
Yeah.
Which is one word. Can't say it. But one.
Yeah, fair. If you go there and you say, was lucky enough to visit business class, very nice, like I quite enjoyed it, fine. Admit that you've done that, not a problem. But don't come home and make it look like you've sat there the whole time when mummy's paid for your flight back in the back of the plane, because we know you're full of horse manure, I'm afraid.
Reese piping up with another wonderful comment that had us chuckling just then, which was, like someone sprawled out, it's probably me waiting for my seatbelt extender. Very good.
Nice.
Come watch us more. You know, that's all I'm going to say. But yeah, fantastic.
That could be his new dating profile, couldn't it? Reese the broken mattress.
I was just thinking more of the seatbelt extender.
You're going to have to change his name in the chat later on now.
Yeah. Absolutely, 100%. You know that's happening. But yeah, I've seen it before. Like, you got people that go to, I mean, I've only flown on like small planes and stuff, but you see it quite regularly. That you've got that certain type of person, and then they'll take a photo and it's a really nice seat, and you think, you don't belong there. You don't belong there. And you read the caption where it's like, oh, business was wonderful. Mm. Yeah, what, for the 10 seconds that you were there before you sat back in the economy? Get out.
it drives you mad. Just be honest. Like, the fact you flew on X plane is perfect. Everyone's excited that you flew on a 350 or a Dreamliner or whatever. Yeah. Don't come here with your web of lies. Like, what else are you lying about in your life? If you're lying about that, then I wouldn't trust you as far as I could throw you. I'm outraged and disgraced.
If mummy's paying for your flights, you are part of the Alvins of the world.
Exactly. <Yeah. laughs> And
having go on.
Your thoughts.
And you couldn't, if you're of that ilk, you can further fake it, because for 30 quid, you can go in the lounge before before a flight. So you're happy to pay 30 quid, you can go and sit in the lounge, make it look like you've actually done the experience properly, but you'll go to bed empty at night with a piece of your heart missing, and everyone who likes your photos is great, but inside you'll be dying slowly because you know you're a bad
fraud.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Is it? Totally agree. One of your recipes.
it goes back to the social media culture, doesn't it? It's all about how many likes you can get and how popular you can be and stuff like that, isn't it? And that's what it all boils down to. It's all fake and it's all fraud, isn't it?
That's what bothers me. You got these people that are like, oh, so I'm flying from Manchester to Berlin to Helsinki to Baku down to Morocco, and then a short cheeky flight to Gibraltar and then back to Manchester. It's like, yeah, but you didn't pay for that. What's the matter with you? Oh, my trip report. No, that's mummy's bank account that's done that. But don't give me that. Don't lie to me. Don't give me that rubbish.
I'll tell you one thing though, in business you probably do get a boiled sweet, so maybe that's something. Maybe go up there and get yourself a little piece of rock or something.
Wonderful, yeah. From Brighton, you know, the place that you can afford to go. Let us know in the chat what you think in terms of, if you've seen anybody that's kind of, you know, sat in a place where they shouldn't be taking photos purely for Instagram likes or whatever else they choose. I'm sure plenty of people have seen them. I've seen them. Steve's obviously witnessed it.
I would point out, I don't...
Have you come across this at all anywhere? Like anywhere, it doesn't have to be on a plane, but literally anywhere where people are just taking photos for fun of it. For Instagram likes. Can you even hear us? That would be the next question.
Yeah, I don't think you can.
I'm thinking, yeah. I mean, it's not something to pay attention to or take any notice to. So
well, that's fair enough. It's a short answer. We'll go with it.
I once posed outside a church in a wedding suit for some likes.
Yeah.
I don't think I've done anything of the sort. I'm sure I haven't.
Yeah.
You know, mummy doesn't pay for my stuff.
No. Playing Spotter 555 saying he's seen one onto Iceland before. Now, I don't think I'd pose outside Iceland taking photographs for Instagram likes, to be honest.
Was Kerry Katona there?
Kerry Katona, holding a cheesecake in hand.
Yeah.
Martin Waldridge. I shop at Lidl but take selfies at Waitrose.
There you go. Well, that's another thing, isn't it? When you see people going in, we have it up here. We have it's a Preston-based business. It's called Booths, and it's quite nice gear, and it's all locally sourced, you know, food, and it's really, really nice food. But you'll always see people going into the likes of Aldi and Lidl with carrying Booth shopping bags and things like that. And that really, you know, they're just liars, aren't they? Yeah.
Yeah. I refuse to eat Lidl food. So when I visit my brother, he has to go to Sainsbury's to buy me dinner on a shop.
That's just snobbery.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, only the finest for me, please. Only the finest. Wonderful. Let's put this one to bed because this has been quite funny, actually. So I would say put it into the room.
I would say so, definitely.
Excellent. In it goes. Right, next one. I'm going to love this one because I'm going to claim it. It's comparing your channel to bigger channels who aren't related to yours. Funny story, I shall tell you about this. This occurred to me not last week, maybe a week before. I'm trying to think. When did we do that episode? You know, the one that got us a lot of heat from one person. When was that?
Oh, yeah.
About three weeks ago.
No? Yeah,
A good few weeks ago. I had a certain simple somebody who basically decided they were going to message me and spam me, telling me how my channel was nowhere near a certain streaming channel. And no matter what you told them, they were always going back to, well, you know, they're doing this, they're doing that. And I'm like, yeah, but I'm not doing this and I'm not doing that. That's the point. And it just drives me insane because it's like, if you know what my channel is, or anybody that experiences this, if you know what the channel is and you're getting compared to a channel that's got nothing to do with what you're doing, then there's no comparison whatsoever. This one dude, decided that they were going to badger on and say that my channel was far like in superior to a certain streaming channel that, you know, I don't do streaming stuff from airports and stuff. So apparently, you know, unless the background tonight is giving that away, that, you know, I'm not on that plane. I'm not at 38,000 feet during the daytime. So yeah, I don't know if other people have experienced this, where somebody's decided to take a swipe at your own channel or what you're doing and say that somebody else is better or whatever else, and it's got nothing to do with what you're doing. So this is one of mine, and we know about this one because I told you guys in the chat that we got going about this one dude that pestered me for hours on end about it.
Well, to be fair, my YouTube channel's only got 15 subscribers, so whoever takes the mix probably spot on, to be fair.
But... I think that's 8 more than mine's got. I think I've got 7.
Yeah, but I've also seen the videos that are on Steve's channel. So,
yeah.
Most of them are encrypted.
Most of them are very cryptic.
Yeah, and encrypted, channels. You can't look at them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, my YouTube channel was just for failures when I used to play FSX. Bad landings, weren't it? That's what I used to put on mine. Not remember, we used to record them, didn't we, and send them, because it was easier doing it that way through YouTube.
It's funny you should say that, because we hear we have a video. We don't really have a video.
But yeah, I mean, you can't, you know, it's like in oranges with lemons, isn't it? You know what I mean? It's two different things altogether. It's like I watched a fishing channel today and it had 261,000 likes. But it's better than this channel. You know what I mean? It's just totally, it's black and white, isn't it? You know, it's totally different. I mean, it might be about aviation, but it's a total different genre altogether, isn't it?
Exactly.
So you can't like it, can you? You can't
love it. No, absolutely.
Because it's not comparable, is it?
Yeah. And I always say, if it ain't for you, don't bother watching.
Absolutely. Yeah. If you don't want to watch it,
don't try and compare it
to
something that it isn't. That's all.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, yeah, it's like, Lewis Hamilton's rich, like properly rich, and what we earn, we're comfortable. We're both getting by in life, doing our own thing.
Don't make him any better, though, does it?
No, we sit here, we try and be informative, we try and make people laugh, and that's pretty much what we're about. And other channels, they go about their business in a different way, and good luck to them. There's
We ain't doing it from a business standpoint. We're doing it because it's literally our hobby and we want to share the hobby with everybody else.
It's just a bit of fun, isn't it?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, a bit of light-hearted entertainment.
So yeah, I'd say for a nice one, we'll put that in the room, but Steve, have the last say.
I was just going to say, it's a bit like my dad's bigger than your dad kind of nonsense.
Yeah, you want to fight? I'll get my brother on you, that sort of thing.
Yeah, my dad might be smaller, but he owns an Uzi, so good luck.
Fabulous. Right, let's go on to the next one, which is live stream chats and bullying in them. Who wants to claim that one?
I'll claim that one. And what my gripe is, I mean, we've all watched live streams from whoever it is. It's just a generic thing. There's nobody... I'm not pointing the finger at any specific live stream or anything like that, but it goes on in pretty much most of them. And I generally turn comments off when I'm watching live streams and things like that, because I'm interested in what's on the screen in front of me. I'm not interested in what people are saying and what have you. But what tends to happen is, I mean, I'm not the most informed person in the world. I'm not an absolute encyclopedia on aviation or anything like that, and if there's something I don't know and I'm genuinely curious about it, and I was in a chat and then just tap, I could put it in the chat. But then you'd get these people like start sort of picking at you know and like, what, are you stupid or something? Did you not know that it was such and such a thing? And then you start getting it, and it generally tends to be the same. I've seen it in patterns over the years in various streams. And it tends to be the same sort of cluster of the click, if you want, the same cluster of people. And they tend to jump down your throat for not having that kind of knowledge and asking stupid questions. Well, it's not a stupid question, because there's no such thing as a stupid question. If you don't know, you don't know. And if you want that information, then you reach out and try and get it. But there's no need for these keyboard warriors to start jumping down your throat just because you don't know that specific bit of knowledge or whatever, but it goes on. And again, it's just, you know, it's just bullying. And it just, ruins it for everybody, I suppose.
Absolutely.
Yeah, no, can't agree more. Like, we've all done it, Tom, myself, Ian, we've all done it. We've slipped up and we've said something daft. I think I said once I'd like to fly London City to Heathrow instead of to New York, and I think you could have a 787 MAX or whatever, and we just laugh at each other, and that's that. But yeah, there's no need to be nasty and start like calling each other names. It's a mick take, and that's job done. But yeah, just bullying in general, there's no need for it, and all it's going to do is turn people off the hobby, and that no one's better than anyone else in life in general, but
It should be fun and enjoyable for people to watch these like live streams and stuff and feel that they can be comfortable to comment, and they can sort of feel like if they don't know something, they can ask a question. There are some groups, I'll give them this, there are some streams, I can think of one off the top of my head, where if you don't know about a certain thing, you've got people in there that will tell you all about it. And that's it. You don't get ridiculed, you don't get moaned at, you don't get anything else. You just you get your answer for what you're asking.
Absolutely. Yeah. There are some groups like that, definitely.
However, you do get your big sort of groups that have lots of people watching, and you are going to get a handful that seem to think they know everything about aviation and things like that. And that's what does my nuts in, because it's like we're here to educate people at the same time, you know. But if we're trying to welcome more people into it and we're trying to get more people to get involved, then it shouldn't be a case of I know better than you, sort of thing. It's petty, it's ridiculous, it's childish. It really is.
I'm not too proud to admit that on Sunday I was asking Isaac questions that I didn't know, and likewise in return, he asked me questions like, why am I such a bumbling idiot? But all mine were aviation related, to be fair. But yeah, that's how you learn, like talking to people and asking questions. You can either to a book, which no one wants to do, or you can just say, like, Ian, what's this? What's that? Tom, what's this? What's that? And you're not going to be idiots about it, because that's how you improve your knowledge. It's as simple as that.
Well, of course, if you don't ask the question, you're not going to know the answer, and you're never going to learn from it. But like you say, it gets to the point where people are afraid to ask the question because they know that they're just going to get, you know, jumped on, sort of thing.
Like I said, you're supposed to educate other people as well to help everybody along, not just seem to think that you're better than anybody else. And I think that's completely wrong. So I think for that goes into the room, because that's quite a strong subject.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's no need for it.
Yeah. Excellent. And it wasn't an EO, by the way, playing Spotter 555.
It was a Cargo Lux B747 Neo. It'll only mean anything to playing Spotter 555.
It was an Airbus 787 Dream Max. Well, I don't know. Anyway, that's interesting. Why has that happened? All right, onwards. Rob Brown, Plane Spotting, even comments and YouTube vids can go the same way. I posted COP26 stuff and the tree huggers jumped on it. They do. They will do. That's going to be a given.
Well, I mean, fair play. I mean, I understand that they've got a point to bring across and stuff like that, but there's a way of doing things. And if tree huggers do want to jump into a chat about aviation, now I totally understand with aviation, it's an absolute gas guzzler. But it's not what they say, it's the way they say it. And it's that sort of aggression and things like that what, you know, puts you off, sort of thing, isn't it? You know, there's no need to be like that. You can express a point no matter how strong your point is diplomatically, can't you, without being aggressive and jumping down somebody's throat about it. Definitely.
Well, each one of us has got a passion or a love that would be Ava too. That's the way of the world. It would be dull if we all sat around going, I like planes, But the fact we all like different stuff and have a passion for that thing, that's what makes things good. But I don't sit around here and say that, Ian, oh, you're wrong because you don't like football. And I don't sit here and have a pop at Tom going, oh, wrestling's not all that good for me. It's part of who we are. It don't make no difference, does it? You can't do someone down on what they like.
I'm glad you mentioned the wrestling thing, because I'm going to take ownership of the next one, which is the Owen Hart effect for likes. Now, not a lot of people will understand this term, so I've had to explain it to Steve, to Ian, but I'll explain it again anyway. Yeah. So very briefly, 1999, during a live pay-per-view for a wrestling company, a wrestler called Owen Hart unfortunately died during the event. The commentators had to then announce it to the people watching in a very subtle, very tone-like, you know, very monotone, but a lot of sadness, a lot of, like, you know, regretfulness type thing. You know, like you do when you break bad news to somebody. Mm. What me off the most, right, is so you have the reason I'm saying this is because of, we all know what's going on right now in the world, and I've seen so much of it. So much of it on social media, it absolutely, like, makes me sick. Is that you know people that are genuine and you know people that are doing it for the likes.
Mm.
Okay. So I've seen a whole number of posts on Instagram, YouTube, wherever, that will make a little story about the Antonov, right? The Antonov 225, right? This is what's really bugging me the most, is the Antonov 225. And you see people making tribute videos, bringing out the Owen Hart voice by saying, oh, it's, you know, it is such a shame, and, you know, we are, you know, et cetera. But you don't know the facts. Like, you can see it black and white. Antonov themselves has said, we're going to assess the condition. But you got people going, RIP, RIP. It's like, come on now, seriously.
Mm.
Like, come on. Like, you're clearly doing this just to try and drum your viewership up and everything else like that by taking advantage of a shocking thing that's happening right now. Can't mention it for YouTube algorithm reasons, but, you know, it's taking advantage of a situation where, you know, there are casualties and fatalities, and all you can think about is a metal structure that might be damaged or might not ever fly again. And I think it's disgusting. I said it last week. I said it on Sunday. I said, if that's your main concern, and as I've been into aviation pretty much my entire life, for all of my, like, 30 years, from, like, being a young kid and everything else like that, from what I can remember, if you're concerned more about a metal structure over the fact that there's fatalities and stuff, then you need a serious head check. You need to stand in front of the mirror, have a long look hard at yourself, long hard look at yourself, and wonder, what the are you doing? Like, seriously, that's my view. Yes, you're allowed to be sad about a plane that you may never see again, but, you know, you can rebuild that. You can't rebuild what else is happening.
Tom.
I say, to use that to get likes is shameful, absolutely shameful.
No,
it's a milk discussion.
If we'd lost it in a one off event, if it had a problem and it'd gone down, or if we'd all share in the sadness, it hasn't. It's gone because of a massive humanitarian problem, and it's insignificant. It's I don't like to say it, but it's like being upset that they lost 4 planes on 9/11 rather than the grand scheme of things. That's sort of how callous and crass.
That's exactly how it comes across, YouTube. Steve. Yeah. And it takes you back to, it's the social media culture again, isn't it? And that's what it's boiling down to. It's about just these selfish individuals who are just constantly looking for this 15 minutes of fame, aren't they? They're looking for the likes. They're not going to get anything positive out of it ever. Mm. Ever. Nothing's ever going to come good out of it.
So it's like what you said about the flight radar thing, wasn't it?
I beg your pardon.
It's like what you were saying about the flight radar thing. People just sit and wait for something to happen, and then they'll go and post it on Facebook. But if they see something like this, where it's like, oh, great, you know, I can make thousands of views on this. Bang, I'm going to go jump straight on it.
Absolutely.
The sympathy card.
You're right. Yeah, and I totally agree with what you were saying, Tom. And if that's how they see what's going on and things like that, then they need to look in the mirror and look at themselves, don't they, and give themselves a serious head check. Because, like you say, it whatever it is, it can be rebuilt, can't it, if it wants to be rebuilt. And, you know, and God, I don't know. It's sickening. It really, really is. They are sick individuals. They really, really are. And to do it just for fame, it's ridiculous.
To be fair, I've seen it done with class. I know young Marco watched the show. He put one of his pictures up and he put a lovely piece about how sort of insignificant the actual aircraft is. And he wrote a nice tribute, and it was done correctly. But for other people, like you say, Tom, who just go out to drive views up, it's disgusting. It's just completely immaterial.
Yeah. And I can, I'm never going to mention the name of the people who have I actually seen. I've seen quite a few of these posts coming up as well. And it's not the actual thumbnail, if you want, of the actual video. It's not like you were saying about Marco being sympathetic towards it and things like that. And we are aware of what's going on and things like that. But it's like splashed across the screen like a Sunday Sport headline or something like that, and it's watch this video here and click on this link here and this, that, and the other, and it's sort of been glorified, if you will, you know, and they've sort of tried to make it pop where things like that, you know, if it was the inaugural flight of the new plane coming into Heathrow Airport, then fantastic, and give it as much, you know, make it pop and make it scream and make it look really, really. But when it's something like that, it needs to be dealt with a little bit differently. And I think it shows a lot of immaturity in these kinds of people who are producing this kind of stuff just for the fame. It's just showing that, you know, they've just got absolutely no maturity whatsoever, have they?
No.
Absolutely.
And I think, unfortunately, we're going to see it for quite some time.
I'm sure. Yeah.
100%. But that's going into the
absolutely.
Drone. Yeah, no, it just lacks class. Absolutely lacks class.
Yeah, classless. Absolutely. Spineless at the same time. Right, next one. Let's move on from that one to one that I can relate to. However, I'm not going to be talking about it. It's calling yourself a pilot on Instagram when you've only had a taster lesson. Who wants to own up to this one?
Me.
Steve.
Right, listen up and listen up good, because if you're one of these, I might follow you tonight. You get people and they'll follow you and they'll say, oh, pilot Dave, pilot Emma, whatever, and you'll be like, oh, cracking pilot, I wonder what wonder what he or she flies. It might be a 320, 321, and I get all excited and follow back, because you'll always guarantee it'll be one of those private account, so you don't actually get to see until they've lured you in with their deceitful lie of webs, web of lies, web I should say. Yeah, that one. And they're expecting to see this amazing pilot, and what you're confronted with is someone who once held controls for 10 seconds at cruising altitude in a Cessna, and suddenly thinks they got stripes and their middle name to Biggles, and it's not just embarrassing for them, it's embarrassing for their family, their friends, their loved ones, and it's just, you're not a pilot. On that basis, I've driven a super yacht, because I happened to walk one on one once as it was bobbing around in the harbour. It don't make me a captain of a boat, and just sort your lives out. Like, you're not what you say you are. Like, you're an embarrassment. And
I totally understand with that one, Steve, and I can relate to that. I've had Instagram followers as well, and like you say, it's pilot this and pilot that, and when you do click on them and when you do get to see the content, it'll just probably have one picture, and it'll be them stood or even just leant against a cockpit door of a Cessna or something like that, and you know, they're again, it's just that light culture again, isn't it? It's just these people just want people to follow them for whatever reason, don't they?
Sat in an electric lightning at Bournemouth Air Museum. I'm not claiming to have done any covert operations for the military. Just you're full of it, and I'm not having it. You need to sort it out. Change your name to I had a go at being a pilot for 10 seconds, and I'll give you some respect. Until then, you're not.
I had a follower who did a lot of flight sim stuff and called himself a pilot.
Oh, really?
I never unfollowed anybody quicker than that person.
I mean, you're onto something now, because I could I could change my tag on my Instagram now and call myself a sim pilot or something like that, couldn't I? Yeah, I went A320 Neo pilot, and then in brackets, on flight sim in small letters.
And while I'm at it, people who call themselves future pilot as well. Like, literally, your mum's milk is still wet on your top lip. Like, learn how to ride a bike. Oh, and then once you've mastered that, get in a car. And then if you can afford it or whatever, then you'll become a pilot. But don't call yourself future pilot and you're a good 20 years off, because, again, it's an embarrassment. Like, yeah, don't claim anything until it's happened. And it's happened for more than a minute as well, because until that point, you're a fraud, a fake, and I've got no time for you.
No.
Got brilliant.
I've just checked my Instagram follow, and it's gone down by about 4,000 people.
And while you're at it, take your feet off that seat next to you.
I'll check the video, and we've got our weekly dislike, which, you know, I think that's supposed to hurt our feelings, but it really doesn't. Because what you're doing is you're actually helping us out, and I think I know who it is. I will find you. And that's all I'm saying. I know who it is. I know exactly who it is. But yeah, we've got time for one or maybe two more, depending on how quickly we do these. So we're going to go for who would like to take ownership of the general cost of flying.
I'll do this one. Now, it's not, I mean, flying is expensive. We know it's expensive. Now, take the low-cost carriers out of the equation here, just like, we know that flying to America on an A330 or whatever, return flight, £750 or whatever, it's not cheap. But you expect to pay that. It's when I get my sister to drop me off down at Manchester Airport, and it costs her a tenner to drop me off, and she's only there for 2 seconds dropping me off. Then I go into the terminal, and I think, you know, I could do with a brew. And it's just cost me a fiver for a brew, or £8 for a pint or whatever it is. And then I might even nip into a fast food outlet and just get myself something to eat, some 2 hours early for my flight and what have you. Well, that's just set me back another £12 to £15. So I've spent nearly £50 or £60 just getting myself a couple of pints of lager and a McDonald's or whatever it is, just sat waiting for my flight. And it's the cost of you. It's the actual cost to yourselves of actually getting to the flight, not actual the price of the flight itself. You think that these establishments, these airports, would want you in their place. And because if you're not going to that place, then they're not going to get any money out of you. Now, I'd rather, years ago, somebody said to me, a little bit of something is better than a load of nothing. Now, if I keep going to Manchester Airport and getting flights and it's costing me an absolute arm and a leg, then I've just got to Liverpool Airport and get it there where it's a damn sight cheaper to do it, because their overheads are lower or whatever. They're not as greedy as what some of these airports are. But it's just the general cost of you actually going from the car park, or even getting to the car park, to actually stepping on the plane. It's frightening. It really, really is. And you can relate it to like petrol stations and you're not petrol, you know, motorway services. They've got a captive audience. So if you want it, you've got to pay for it. And I just don't think it's right.
I'd like to add to that with a particular low cost airline that will basically give you the option to buy a flight from, you know, let's say somewhere in the UK to like a Poland or a Czech Republic or something like that. And then you look at it and you think, well, do you know what? Like £9.99 like each way, not bad. Like with the extra booking and stuff, about £20, right? £20 you put in your car, sort of thing. And you'd be like, okay, do you know what? I'll do that. until you have to check your bag in, which is about 90 quid.
Mm. Yeah.
So already you're looking at over £100 for that. And then if you want your leg space or you want this and you want that, you know, it's money on top of that. So you're not actually getting great value unless you literally go somewhere with just the clothes you've got on your back.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. I totally agree with that. But then I would say as a counter argument to that, these low cost airliners can't fly you to Krakow or whatever it is for a tenner, can they? Let's be real. They can't do it. It's just not viable, is it? If 100 people got on the next Ryanair flight at Manchester Airport in the clothes that they were just wearing, and they all got the flight for a tenner apiece, there is no way that flight would have enough fuel in it. If they had to pay for fuel out of what you paid for your ticket, it wouldn't even get to out of taxi, would it? Let's be honest. So they've got to charge, haven't they? They've got to get the money from somewhere, the revenue in from somewhere. And if that's the only way they can do it, by charging for a bagger, charging for extra legroom, charging a fiver for a half can of lager on a flight or whatever, this revenue's got to come from somewhere for these flights to be economical. Otherwise, there's no point in doing it.
Yeah, I always offset the cost of the airport by, when I'm in duty free, getting a taster bottle of every aftershave and spraying it on an item of clothing each. So that's how I offset the cost of that.
Yeah.
And if you can stomach the taste, because you've got to buy polos because you won't get sweets these days, just have a little spray in your mouth because it's pure alcohol, and then you just whap a mint in afterwards, and then that'll get rid of the taste in that. So that's how you can do it on the cheap there, Ian.
Honest to God.
I was taking notes then, Steve, why are we saying that?
Yeah. But no, you're right. It's like a service station. It's an absolute conk. So they've got you. There's nowhere to go. Like a well-known airport in the south of London charged me £6.50 for a pint of Stella. I couldn't believe it. Mm. And it was a Wetherspoons as well, allegedly.
It's just extortion, isn't it?
Yeah, and there's nowhere you can go. And I think I bought some kind of chicken tikka wrap thing, and it would have been cheaper to fly to India and have it cooked for me than it was to buy it there, to be quite honest.
Yeah, probably right. And I bet it wasn't the nicest tasting thing either, were it?
I can't remember. Obviously went down.
Rob Brown, PlaneSpotting, pointing out the actual flight cost isn't the problem. It's the in-flight service and airports ripping a hole out of a captive market.
Absolutely.
Spot on. I've got time for another quick one. We'll put that in the room, of course. Seems to be like a general kind of chat about that. We'll do a very quick one. And a bit controversial, but we'll end it with it. British Airways using the 777s on flagship New York routes. Who wants to claim this one then?
Yep, I'll have it.
Go on then.
Yeah, the Heathrow to New York route is their flagship route. Like BA have said it themselves, there's no denying it. And for me, they should be using better aircraft in the 777 to show off the brand. They should be using 50s, 380, and if they're and Boeing in America, even the 787s are a better looking plane than the 777 to sort of promote the brand. And that's kind of my main issue. I've nothing against the 777 as such, but I think it would be better served for the company to New York on their flagship route to send some of their newer, more modern, better looking aircraft across. So, that's my beef with it, to be honest.
Interesting. Ian?
I agree with you, Steve, in a lot of ways. I think that if it's a flagship service, and then I would certainly put a 350 on it. I think that's the way forward with it. I mean, it's probably the nicest looking plane out there at the moment, especially for long-haul routes or something like that. But it might also have something to do from a business point of view. I know we do it at work with our wagons, and the newer wagons will do shorter routes, and it keeps the mileage down and things like that. And then eventually, as they start getting older, they'll start being put on longer routes and things like that to get the mileage up, to get them to where they need to be so they can get them replaced. And you could, the 777, they might employ the same kind of philosophy where you have to put it on these shorter routes or these longer routes or whatever, just because of, I don't know, the age of the plane or whatever, whatever the airline needs at that particular moment, at that particular time. I mean, I don't know what the business class on a 777 compared to the business class on an A350. I don't know how different it would be, or the first class, how different it would be, because you'd still get quite a lot of business people going to New York, and maybe the 777 can accommodate them a lot better than what a 350 can. And ultimately, at the end of the day, they just want to get to New York. They're not bothered about how they get there, as long as they're sat in comfort and there's plenty of room for them. And maybe the 777's kitted out just that little bit better. I don't know.
Yeah, I just think as a flagship route, you should be using your flagcraft.
Definitely use a 350. Yeah.
So, yeah, that's
good shout. Wicked. There we go. Right, something a little bit different for this Wednesday evening, where we go from positive to negative on what we've been doing. Hopefully you've enjoyed that. Hopefully it's not, caused too much controversy, I'm sure.
Chelsea scabbing a win. How's that for controversy?
Oh, I had a little match of the day. Well done.
Sorry, mate.
Yeah. Alan Hansen down there, look. but no, hopefully that was enjoyable, and hopefully it was a different side to us being all positive and stuff. We thought we'd go down the moaning route. However, we return to positivity next week.
Absolutely.
Just before we start to wrap the show up, it is of course competition time, where tonight we launch our competition that we have going. Over the last sort of 7 days, we've been talking about launching a competition where one lucky person will have their t-shirt design launched onto our shop. We think this is a nice little give back to somebody that might sort of want to contribute to the shop as well. All you have to do is design a t-shirt, basically. Find a blank template of a t-shirt, design it, draw it, hand draw it, take a picture, whatever you have to do. Send it to us on direct messenger. Obviously, we'll run the competition for a while to get people to sort of take part and be in with a chance to win. So the competition is officially launching now. So if you want your t-shirt design to feature on our shop, like I say, the shop is doing quite well at the moment. People are buying t-shirts, hats, mugs, the lot. So if you want your design to feature in that, get designing, send it to us on our social medias, in the direct messages, which you can find in the descriptions below. Also, we'll put these out on social media as well over the next sort of 24 hours, just to let everyone know. So good luck to those that want to enter. Right. So next week, next Wednesday, we are rating the retros. We're going through retro liveries of new and sort of in the past that are no longer around, and we're rating them in how much we like them, how much we don't like them. And we're just going to have a nice, relaxing evening talking about retro liveries. There are a good handful out there, so including the tap one, which we mentioned earlier in the show. So there's quite a few out there to pick. Airline of World, I'm just going to bring this up here. Airline of World says, has this live stream started or finished? Well, we're live and we are sort of wrapping the show up. We do go live 7:30 p.m. on a Wednesday. Next Wednesday, rate the retros. Should be a lot of fun. Just off the top of your heads, I mean, we've all got a favourite here, but Steve, a favourite retro livery?
Oh, I'm going to avoid the British Airways one just because it is so obvious. So maybe the Aer Lingus one's quite a nice one to spot at Heathrow. So I'll go for that off the top of my head.
Wonderful. Ian?
Yeah, I watched the 777, the Qatar 777 coming into Manchester last week, and as it was approaching, the two cheat lines, what they have down the side, the top cheat line, it's like it wraps all around the front of the plane. Well, they both do, to be quite honest. And as you see it coming in, it doesn't look like it's got any windows, and it just looks like it's part of the cheat line. And it's quite a bizarre thing when you look at it in that respect, but what an absolute stunning plane it is. So the Qatar 777, definitely.
Yeah, that looked fantastic.
Because I don't like it.
I'll give you that.
Yeah, I don't like it.
Oh, see, I loved it.
Yeah, it looked really smart, yeah.
Mine would be, if I had to pick one, and I'm going to... If I had to pick a retro, I would go for...
Don't mention British Airways.
No, that's what I'm trying to stay clear of.
All right.
Do you know what? After seeing it on Friday, I'd go El Al, the Israeli airline, with their retro Dreamliner.
Right.
I'd go with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I can't say I've seen it, to be honest. So whether I've seen it in passing, I've not really touched much notice. But
I like it. It's it reminds me of the livery that I sort of grew up with, the more sort of modern version of it before they went to the one they've got now. So really nice. Gulf Air is always a good one as well.
Definitely, yeah. Rob Brown, plane spot, and he's saying cargo looks retro. He's biased, he knows, he says, but the cargo looks retro. I'm sure that will definitely get a shout out there because I'm a massive fan of cargo looks anything, to be honest. I think the
retro is quite nice. The retro is quite nice. Just trying to think if there's any other sort of types of retros off the top of my head. We'll save that for next week.
Save it for next week.
Absolutely. So we're going to rate the retros next week. Should be a lot of fun. So for now, we are going to do the part of the show where we start to do some shout-outs and wrap the show up. So, Ian, as you disappeared last week and we completely forgot to shout you out, you can go first.
Yeah. Massive thanks to everyone in chat tonight. See you next week. Massive thanks to you, Tom, and to you, Steve, again, for an interesting chat tonight. Massive shout out to everyone in chat as well, and to Tian as well. She's only commented once, but she's knocking about somewhere. And I'll special shout out there to Marco Barrett, who just slipped in at the end there. So, hi, guys. Sorry I'm late. Hope I've not missed much. You've missed everything, Marco. Yeah.
Everything's at the end of the show.
Yeah. And shout out to Sausage Rolls, who wasn't even trapped tonight. So,
he was trapped in tonight.
Yeah, definitely. No, just massive shout out to everyone in chat tonight. And it was a great show. Well done, chaps.
Yeah, thank
you,
Martin
Waldridge. Yeah, to quote Martin Waldridge.
There you go. Great stuff.
Yeah.
Right, Steve, you next.
Yeah, well, as I'm watching, shout out to my Send Money, Mother's Day and Mum's Birthday. Do it soon. Thank you. everyone else who's been good enough to join in the chat tonight, we always appreciate you being there, and those who have just in the background as well. We don't know you're there as such, but your message, we do sort of know you and appreciate your support. And to Tom and Ian, as always, it's always a pleasure and that. And even though I did it at the top of the show, I'm going to self plug myself again. Follow my Instagram, Steve_Planes on Instagram. If you're a new follower, I might not be too big time to write to you back. So do that, and we'll have a little chat, and we can discuss all things aviation.
Yeah.
All right, and that's me, lad.
Can I just ask a question? Does your Martin know about bank transfers and things like that? Or does he still send it in an envelope with a stamp on?
Do you know the best thing in the world? Even though we're both quite old, Mum and Dad still get one card, and Martin signs it and then posts it with 20 quid in it, and then I sign it, and then I'll go out and buy something to the value of 40 quid.
Hey, isn't it wrong with that? Isn't it wrong with that?
And there's a at Christmas, you'll enjoy this. Mum gets a an amaryllis plant. And every year, without fail, even though I know where I am, I go up to the bloke working there and say, can you show me the away to Amaryllis, and it always gets a little chuckle.
Oh, bloody hell. Yeah. Nice. Guys, getting more like Royston Vasey every day down in Verwood, isn't it? Wherever it is you live.
Well, and if you haven't got any, we're Back to the Fuchsia.
End it now. Yeah. Cracking. Right. I'll do some shout outs, then we'll quickly wrap the show up. So, shout out to everybody who has been watching this evening, even the late comers and people lurking in the background. We know you're there. Big thank you to you guys. Big thank you to you, Steve, for obviously like doing a wonderful job. And that's about it. So, no, shout out to Ian for a wonderful job as always, providing us with a, you know, what I'm going to end up doing, because you do such like, you do give us really good stats, is I'm going to create like a little montage or a little video that we can play every time you give us a stat, you know, providing one, I get your approval, and two, nobody comes after me because of it.
Well, you know, I'm quite a sensitive chap, so.
Yeah.
Well, it is snowflake season, just, you know, like scat man, just stat man instead.
Yeah, it sounds cool.
Yeah. I'll work on that, I'm sure. Everybody watching in the comments as well, for your contributions tonight. And then one last shout out to that one special person who I know is watching, probably in the background, knowing them, but I love you very much, and thank you for everything you've done for me over the last few days. Much appreciated, especially with what's happened, which I'm not going into. We're going to wrap the show up now. So a big thank you to everyone again for watching. We'll be back on next Wednesday, but Steve, if you'd like to say your goodbyes to the wonderful people still watching.
I would. There's one more I think we all forgot, actually, to be fair, and I don't think he's ever watched. He's certainly not commented before, and that was Reese joining us. So thanks for joining us tonight, Reese.
Yeah, it was a nice surprise there. Yeah.
If indeed you are still watching, yes.
But if you're not, then thanks for coming in. It was some good comments. You made us laugh.
Mm. So. Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, nice. Well, I'm going to hit it big style again, because I know people appreciate the new outro. So cheerio, my lovelies. Stay safe, stay sexy, and until next time, take care. Goodbye now.
Brilliant. Thank you, Steve. All right, Ian, over to you.
Just thanks to everybody again who's been in chat tonight, and thanks to you again, Tom, and thanks to Steve as well. And just stay safe, and hope to see you all here again next week for our retro show. Fantastic.
Absolutely.
Bye. Nice.
Wait for it, because Rob Brown Plane Spotting is asking me to do it, so I'm going to do it.
Nice.
There you go. There we go. We shall see you next week. Wonderful. And from me, enjoy the rest of the week. Have a wonderful weekend. Come up with some retro planes, liveries, etc. that you can think of for our show next week, because we will want your contributions as well. But until then, we will see you next Wednesday, 7:30 p.m. for another episode of the Departure Lounge podcast. Have a fantastic rest of the week, guys, and see you next week. I'm not prepared for this. I am now. Bye.